And now it is time to welcome Tara Campbell to the Writer Center stage. I'm going to switch over my view here so I'm seeing you properly instead of a tiny little thumbnail. So if you have your book handy, do you have your book handy? Do you have something short that you could read from it? Just a few paragraphs or something you want to read? Or you said you might have something else to get us started. Yes. So I'll hand off to you to get us started.
Yeah, so it's the end of the week. A lot of folks are coming in from work or other concerns. And this exercise just came to me because for some reason I was getting a lot of requests coming into my email box on a Friday afternoon. And so I thought maybe we could just take a moment to let go some of that stress and just mute yourself. You're already muted. I'll mute myself. You can turn off your screen. Drop as many F-bombs as you need to exercise this week from your psyche or whatever curse word of choice or primal scream, whatever. You're muted. You can like turn around or turn off your screen. And for 5 seconds, we're just going to like let go and get all that stuff from the week out. So I will count us and go ahead and let loose. All right, so I'll start the counting now. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and we're back. I found that to be incredibly helpful, and nobody had to witness me doing it, but I wanted to give all of you a chance to sort of let that go. Yes, with no further ado, I thought I would read, you know what, I was going to read one thing, but I think I'll switch to another thing, just because we need some hope at the end of the week, because I was just listening to the news and I need some hope. So this is a poem I like to read at the end of readings, and if any of you remember a few years ago, toward the beginning of the administration, the CDC was advised to avoid certain words in its reporting and funding requests in order to assure that it would receive the support it needed from the administration. So I wrote a poem based on these 7 words and phrases, and I called it "In Contradiction to the Commander's Standards and Wishes." I base my poetry on science, in contradiction to the commander's standards and wishes. I sing of diverse transgender fetuses, write evidence-based verse in praise of science-based wonders, rhyme vulnerable with beautiful, while capital millionaires line their pockets with non-chlorophyllic green and almost forget to chip the children in their trickle-down amnesia. I base my poetry on science, in consideration with community standards and wishes, based on faith in reason, in empathy, in data, in compassion, in knowledge, in questioning, in resistance. Thank you.
Thank you. So other than the author of that poem and other than the person who gave us free rein to scream for 5 seconds during the time where screaming was necessary, just what is the elevator pitch of who Tara is?
Well, I am a DC-based writer and teacher. I am also an editor, a fiction editor at Barrel House, and I actually enjoy teaching. So in addition to teaching at the Writer Center, I teach at American University, Politics and Prose, and the National Gallery of Art. And that's actually lesson planning and sort of talking about people's stories and helping them create new ones is one of the things that actually helps me decompress and relax from everything going on in the world.
And you're one of the Writer Center's favorite people, so we should throw that out there too. So yes.
Thank you.
I got to read an advanced copy of this book, so that was great. So the fun thing of that too is though, so I'd read it and went back and glanced through my actual real physical book copy, which everyone should buy. Oh, there's a scary
yeah,
lightning bolt.
Yeah. I heard that.
Okay.
Wow.
So Amy, please be ready to grab hold of this if I don't have power here in a moment. So there were so many interesting, it's interesting, first of all, because it's so different than how I approach writing. So it was very, and I mean that in a good way. It's like it forced me to think very carefully about how I would want to ask you questions. And also, though, made me realize how there are some similarities of concerns that we probably have going forward with these things. I was thinking of one of them was this idea of timeliness versus timelessness, and how there was certainly among probably a certain generation of writers, this value of timelessness, that it was, you wanted your work to withstand the test of time, whatever that means. And for some people that meant, like in the early days of cell phones, you didn't write about cell phones because that would date it into a particular time frame. Of course, now we all have cell phones still. So anyway, so it was just, that was in my head reading about this, because it's, this collection is so much about the specific moment. I mean, sadly, it's relevant to many other moments as well, but it is in the specific moment. So am I reading that correctly, though, that do you feel that this is definitely a work of the moment? Before I assume that, I want to ask you outright, is that what you feel like when you read your own work from this collection?
Yeah, I have to say, I don't even really think about where this work stands in the literary firmament. This particular book is a compilation of things that I wrote, you know, starting in 2016. And at the time, I wasn't thinking in terms of a collection. I was responding to outrages and injustices that were going on in the world at the time. And so this is something that I was doing alongside other work. And that's been something that is important for me, to be able to write to what I'm feeling at a time and not feel boxed in by certain parameters or what I am supposed to be accomplishing. So this collection is really sort of the fruition of all of those individual efforts of sort of letting myself express myself at various points in time. And to the question of timelessness, it can be a slippery term, because it's often mingled with this connection to canonical ideas of art and what art is supposed to be and who and what it's supposed to be speaking to. And so there has traditionally been a certain way of looking at universality. But that idea of universality and timelessness has often been filtered through a certain aesthetic, meaning, you know, upper middle class white male aesthetic. And that's who was defining what art is and what something, you know, how something has to look to be timeless. And so there has often been this feeling that being too specific about life is a deficit to a work. and really what it comes down is to is being too specific about certain lives that is seen as less worthy. So you can be specific about a bird call in the woods, or, you know, the quiet desperation of a white family in Connecticut, and somehow that's qualified to be timeless, right? But if you start talking about women's rights or pain in Black communities, somehow that is too specific and too of the moment, and it doesn't qualify for this sort of rarefied atmosphere of being timeless and being literary. And what I see now that has been amazing to watch is this recognition that there are more ways of defining what is timeless and what is universal and what is worth, you know, putting on that syllabus. And I'll just say one thing, because this question just got me sort of thinking about what timelessness means. But on a certain social media site that some people hate now, a friend of mine actually was talking about Ursula K. Le Guin's The Ones Who Walk Away from O'Malley's as a text that could help you start thinking about whiteness. And this is a white man saying this text could be an entryway to help people think about what whiteness means. And I just thought that was an amazing way to look at a text that was not written about that necessarily. It was written about a larger issue of privilege, but certain works find their way into discourse, you know, centuries hence, because no matter how general or specific they are, they're getting at a larger idea, something central like prejudice or like fairness or privilege. And those larger ideas can come in very specific packages or very general packages, but that those ideas is what really can give a piece timelessness.
I think too, there's something about what is timeless is accepted as timeless because of longevity and convention. It's not because someone thought they were writing a timeless thing.
Exactly.
We talk about Shakespeare still because of a certain quality to the work, but there was not, I mean, I can't read Shakespeare without like the annotated version. You know, I don't understand what half the references mean. So it's
right.
It's not timeless in the sense of just universally understandable for all time.
Right.
Do you have any goal when you're setting out? Like, do you consider not necessarily timelessness, but grand dialogue? Is there like something broader you feel yourself inserting, making an entry into the conversation? Or do you just write and know that that's, I mean, do you think of that consciously? Is it more subconscious? Because I feel like there must be some recognition you're writing to a larger moment, but anyway.
No, you know, it's funny. I approach my writing very, I'm coming at writing later than a lot of folks who have known since they were, you know, start reading books that they wanted to be writers. For me, it's been really about writing to what interests me at the time, which explains why all of my books are just so weirdly different. You know, writing about trees and writing about politics, and they're not related, really, is a sign that I, you know, fortunately, I have the luxury of writing things that pique my interest. So for this collection, it was really my reaction at the time, and it was really my attempt to think through what I'm reading in the news. Why is it making me feel this angry? The first step is just getting it out, right? Before it eats me up inside. Now, whether that turns into a published work is a different matter. But where all of the works in this collection started was my emotional reaction and thinking, in many cases, this is bullshit. And putting it down to really deal with it and figure out, well, okay, why is it bullshit? Where's the source of the bullshit in this whole scenario here. So all of the pieces started as me trying to figure out and really sort of interrogate myself, interrogate my reaction and figure out why I feel the way I do. And is it justified? And so a lot of the works led to additional research, right? The first draft is your gut. And then every draft after that is a more informed interpretation. So I would find myself, for example, there's a poem in here about a case where a jury found the death of a father was awarded a 4-cent award after he was killed by police in his own garage, listening to music in his own garage. And I just thought, okay, that is too wildly inappropriate and unbelievable to be true. But my first draft was like, what the F? And then I did more research and I looked at additional articles and got, you know, the full scope of the story. And that was about me wanting to know. I didn't have in mind where I would publish this or who would be reading it or what space it would take in the literary world. This is really about me being outraged, but then informed, which is the crucial part that so many folks are missing today. But I want to be that responsible writer and really know what I'm writing about before I put it out in the world.
That's great. So real quick, while we're in between questions here, did want to mention that we welcome questions from people in the audience. If you have a question, please use the chat feature. If you're on your PC, you just hover your mouse over the bottom of the Zoom screen and click the chat button, and it'll pop up on the side. Just type your question in there, and we'll get to as many questions as we can before the end of the evening. So I wanted to start right away with rage, but I wanted to work up to rage a little bit. So now I'm moving on to my rage questions. Because this book is beautiful rage, if I can make up a phrase right here on the spot. But I'm interested in the craft of emotion, how craft works when you're writing about emotion. I tend to write away from emotion, or at least find a way to approach emotions from the side. But this is a collection that not only comes at emotions head on, but it embraces rage. It's fueled by it. So in a way, I mentioned, like, so different to me, in a way that makes me uncomfortable, in the way that good literature makes you uncomfortable, that makes you confront the way you approach things and reconsider and recognize deficiencies sometimes in the way you tend to approach things. So I was grateful for that. But why did you opt for this direct approach?
I think it gets back to that wanting to understand. And, you know, sometimes rage takes the form of humor. Like when something is just so bad, you have to laugh at it. And so it's allowing myself to, allowing myself these modalities, because these are not the only things I'm writing. And it may seem concentrated in this book, but it's part of expression. And it's, I think it's a healthy thing for writers to allow themselves to feel rage. But that's just the first step, right? So write mad, edit more informed. And know that what you're writing may never make it into the world and may not even like belong in the world. But I think the worst thing you could do is sort of edit yourself before you even get started. So this is the culmination of years of writing mad and setting it aside and coming back to it later and really coming from a place of wanting to understand what it is I'm seeing in the world.
I love that. I also love that I feel like a lot of us who read it early focused on the rage aspect, but it also has a lot of humor. Like, I'm a marketer. I'm always trying to find that one thing to focus on, but there's a lot of humor in here as well. So that's a very good point as well. And talking about rage, that rage has more than one face too. So you've mentioned this some in the revision process, but I'm interested in balancing this directness, this rage with nuance, because this isn't us muting, screaming for 5 seconds. That's not what these poems are. So how do you approach that balance? Is it something you consider in first drafts, or do you let the first draft be the scream and then only in revision? And we'll talk more about revision later if we don't cover it here. So yeah.
Yeah, definitely the first draft is not where I start looking at the news accounts, right? The first draft is where I figure out what happened, right? And I'm writing about it because it has evoked a reaction out of me. Now, in some cases, the reaction is curiosity, which is how my novel came to be. But in some cases, it's rage, right? And rather than spilling it out on Facebook, you know, a more productive way of dealing with that at times is to write it down and figure it out. And so, of course, you know, the editing part is where nuance comes into it. And I think, you know, sort of the more blatant the outrage is, the more humor sometimes that I approach it with. And that's kind of the nuance. So satire is, you know, a wonderful tool because it allows you this kind of rage that's also very smart. You know, A Modest Proposal is one of these timeless works because the satire works so well. And it's a model for sort of directing your anger and making people question their assumptions, that this cold-blooded idea could be written as an actual proposal that may not, you know, look that dissimilar from other proposals governments come up with to solve problems. And so the nuance comes in expressing that rage in a new way and in a way that makes your reader ask questions themselves and not just like take in your rage and you know, act as a vessel for your emotion. But my goal is to involve the reader and have the reader start asking questions too, saying, yeah, this is kind of ridiculous. Why are we letting this happen? You know, well, who is this person to tell us it should be that way? So that's, you know, the nuance comes in channeling the rage in a productive manner and one that challenges the reader as well.
So this isn't quite about rage, but it's a corollary, I think, is how do you keep yourself safe, you the person versus you the author, when you're publishing works that are so charged and are going to be polarizing? I agree with you, but there are people who don't. And I'm a person, on the contrary, who, like, I won't post a, a serious thought on Twitter. I mean, I have shied away from the social media platform that we're all scared of now. I am totally scared of it. So how do you, again, is that something you worry about, or do you just create the work and feel the need to create it and share it?
I think the way I kind of, give myself a little insurance against the outrage is, again, to do my research before I post. If I can tell you why I said what I said, then I feel more justified in saying it, and I can say it more forcefully. So I'm not one to pop off without, having my receipts and doing some research. And I think that's what gets a lot of people in trouble, because they see one thing and they may not sort of look to see where it came from and who said it and why they might have said it. And so I kind of look at that as, something that civics classes could be and are starting to do more training in. But I think the way I take care of that sort of potential reactions is by checking myself before I say something. And also, I stopped reading my reviews on Goodreads. And I do appreciate people, but if you read too many of those reviews, anything can be dissected and torn apart in ways that don't always make sense or align with an author's intention. So I just don't put myself through that torture.
So if you take nothing away from this chat, do not read the Goodreads reviews. I stopped. When my book first came out, I read a couple just to sort of see, and some hardcore science fiction fan called my book soporific. After I looked that word up to find out what it meant, I was like, oh, that's offensive. And then I was done. So I've not read a review of my book, a customer review of my book, since like the first week it was out. So we have some questions coming in now on the chat. So where we go. Okay, so the first question from Natasha, did you have any mentors that helped you along the way with advice, publishing, et cetera?
Oh gosh, I have to say, for the trash fire that Twitter can be, it can also be an amazingly supportive place. Same for Facebook. There was a group that I joined early on in my writing journey called DC Binders. And that is a community of women writers in the DC area. And they are incredibly supportive in terms of sharing resources and information and encouragement. Same for Twitter. If you find your literary Twitter, you can really get a lot of support. It's not there just to tear you down. Certain sections may, but that's not its function. And just to shout out a couple people that have been very supportive in my early days, Amber Sparks is amazingly supportive and wonderful and has, been kind enough to blurb a couple of my books. And I teach her at almost every class I teach because she's amazing. Rihanna Amilcar Scott also, took me seriously early on as a writer when I hadn't taken myself seriously yet. And, just like very supportive and, respectful as a colleague. And that's kind of what I needed at that time. And then the whole group at Barrel House. I came in about 3 years ago. I had met them through conferences and then being on panels and then organizing panels and then joining the editorial crew. And again, the whole time, like, yeah, you're a writer. Yeah, come on. I'm like, oh, okay. So just that network of supportive people, seeing you really from the outside based on what you are producing rather than all of your inner insecurities and, I'm not in this yet, so being able to have that support from folks who I trust and who believe in me has been just, invaluable.
You mentioned Amber Sparks first, and we should say that we're chatting with her next week. So if you go to the Writer Center events page, you can register for that event with wonderful Amber. And we have a video of our very first chat was with Rian. So we have a couple chat connections going on there. So so we have another chat question. I'm wondering which pieces were the most satisfying to write and see out in the world, from Mina. That's questions from Mina.
That is a good question. I think one that caused me to really investigate identity the most, and that I'm, you know, proud I was brave enough to put out in the world, is The Trouble with Pronouns, where I really talk about how difficult it is as a mixed race person to even start a sentence sometimes, because what is the we and what is the they in whatever we're talking about? It's impossible when you're mixed, right, to know what that means. Like the way other people conceptualize we and they, there is no we and they, right? So I wrote a poem about that, and it was very personal, and but it said exactly what I needed it to say. And so that's one that I come back to when, you know, if you wanted to know like my central issue, like, you know, what's up with me, that is a work I could point to sort of say, that's kind of my, you know, thing in a nutshell.
Next question is coming from Jenny, who has actually been a past chat person as well. So this is chat reunion day here on on Craft Happy Hour. So how do you do research and not let it wreck you? The news is so depressing, and I can imagine a deep dive into it would be overwhelming. So that's an amazingly good question.
Yeah, and it is. And sometimes I have to go on a social media diet and just get away from it. But I think when it feels really heavy, that's when I turn to humor and satire, because again, it's just so laughably bad sometimes that I just have to, you know, just have to spit back that way. So yeah, humor is immensely helpful when it comes to dealing with just the depth of depravity that we face in the news on a daily basis.
Amy points out that we were saying we don't read customer reviews, but if you like a book, you should absolutely write a positive review on Goodreads and Amazon. Don't buy your book at Amazon, but write a good review there. It's a very tricky web we have to weave to be responsible book readers. But yeah, if you can write a review for a book, that goes such a long way to helping it get in front of more people. So thank you, Amy.
Very good point.
From Ron, are there other ways you channel rage in a nuanced way besides satire? What other writing vehicles, forms can we use to express strong emotion in a nuanced way?
I feel poetry, and actually that's a good point. Poetry is what comes out usually when I'm pissed off. Satire is when I'm pissed off and despairing. and then prose is, you know, what can come out either out of a what if question, curiosity, or when I've had time to mull through something a little longer. So there are various modalities that are useful with various, you know, feelings. Other things, it is important as writers to do other things. So for example, before this talk tonight, I got my walk in, I exercised, I knit. And that might be a good time to bring up my alternate virtual background.
Yes.
Because I don't knit anything that makes sense. I knit lips. So this is a pandemic project. So I started knitting these. My mother taught all of us from childhood on, all of her kids, to knit, boys and girls alike, which I love my mother for. You know, she made practical things like baby blankets and, you know, mittens and sweaters and, you know, Christmas stockings, which we still have. So when I knit absolute nonsense, and hence the lips, and I'll move aside so people can see more. So at first this was a meditative thing to help me get over the news, right? But then I wanted to be useful, so I turned it into a fundraiser. And so on my page, my website, taracampbell.com, if you just scroll down a little bit, you'll see hashtag 12 angry lips. And this is a way that I am trying to raise money for organizations like the SPLC, the ACLU, the NAACP, and all of these kinds of organizations that we urgently need right now. So this became something practical because I did something completely impractical. And I have my menagerie with me, actually. Thought I might get a little opportunity to talk about this. So this gives you an idea of like what size the lips are. I, as you can see, I have a lot of inventory here. So visit my page, you can find out how to donate, and to thank folks for coming to the craft talk. I'm offering a half off special. So normally I ask for $50 donations, but if you can donate $25, go fill out the form, go through the process, you know, send me your receipt for $25 donation to one of those organizations or to the Writer Center, because they are also crucial. Then you can get your lips for $25 and you can keep your receipt for donating to a good cause. But yeah, I mean, being a writer is not just about writing, and this is my way of coping, these wild lips behind me.
That was probably not the answer they were expecting, and I love that.
It's all about lips, baby.
So from Patricia, she likes the idea of satire, though she's never used it in her writing. Do you have any advice on how to use it? Is it better to continue satire throughout a piece, or can you mix satire into a piece or a book, as I think Mark Twain does?
You know, there are all kinds of examples out there. McSweeney's is an excellent place to go. You get your little glimpse of all different kinds of satire. Alexandra Petrie is amazing. So there are a lot of examples out there and a lot of ways to do it. And a good way to start is just short, like have a short concept. Don't even think about publication or who's going to be taking it or what have you. Just think about, like, am I saying what I want to say here? And the act of writing it is really, for me, the satisfaction. Yes, of course, I want to get it published afterwards, but I don't even start thinking about that until I am confident that I've said what I want to say in this piece. So yeah, I mean, just start. It could be a list, right? You could have a list of things I would wish on my own worst enemy, right? Because we're feeling a lot of hostility, right? But we don't want to be cruel, but what are some little irritations you would wish on your worst enemy? So you could just take a category like that and start brainstorming. And even if it doesn't wind up in a piece, it'll make you feel better. You won't get arrested because you won't do any of those things. You'll just write them.
And if you like Alexandra Petrie, we're doing a craft chat with her on September 10th. So yes. Sorry,
I didn't know.
It's turning all into a promo. Your chat's turning into a promo for the Writer Center. I'm sorry. So quick question on the lips. Do you use a pattern? What pattern do you use?
Yes, and I will put a link into the pattern. I think actually I do link from it from my page, but I'll just double check. But yes, yeah, so there's an Icelandic artist named Jurari, and she came up with this initial pattern as a way to reclaim sweaters. And so it was basically just the lips, and she would put them on holes in sweaters or whatever. And I saw this and I'm like, this is amazing, but I don't wear sweaters, so I'll just knit the lips. But her Instagram is amazing. She's doing all kinds of shows now, and it's all about, you know, reclaiming clothing, which is, you know, a great thing in itself. But I will make sure that I have linked to that from my website, and then you can get the pattern from the 12 Angry Lips project. So I am checking right now.
I think we hit on this next question a little bit, but this is going a little bit further. So from Melissa, we talked a little bit about how poetry tends to be your rage form. That's where you go when you're feeling rage. But you have success in so many different forms and on so many topics. How do you decide what genre and emotion necessitates, and what role does revision play in that process? Do you ever switch a form once you, like, do you realize a poem doesn't fit a particular rage and you switch something else?
Yeah, you know, that can happen quite often between poetry and prose poetry and flash. And, you know, sometimes I've submitted something as a prose poem and it's been published as, you know, prose and vice versa. So even, you know, at the publication stage, it can morph into another category depending on how the reader is receiving it. But for me, I really let that piece be what it needs to be. And then during the editing stage, I think it happens more often that I will turn a prose piece into a poem, because I don't want to force an arc on it that it would need to have for a piece. And if it's not really coming together as an arc, and if I tried to insert that and it would just sort of make the piece ring false, I will sometimes turn that into a poem, which is more about, you know, a moment and an idea for me. That's not to say that there isn't such a thing as, you know, narrative poetry, you know, so all of these forms can exist in various permutations, which is why you have the ability as a writer to really choose the right form for that, for what you're trying to accomplish, and not to try and force it into a form that you think you're supposed to be writing, or even the form that you started writing. So yeah, I mean, it's fantastic because, you know, I find, you know, sometimes writers kind of get hung up on categories, and I look at it as a way of being liberated, right? Like the limitations can help you start, like a pattern can help you knit, but then you go off the ranch and you start knitting lips that just exist within themselves and live their own best lives and do not need a sweater to exist. So that's how you can write as well. You know, you can use form as a way to start, but you don't have to feel beholden to the form that you started in.
Lesson number one of this chat was don't read the reviews. Lesson number two is knit lips.
Yes.
As metaphor. A couple practical publishing questions from April. Did you have an agent to help you get your book published? Have you had assistance with marketing from your publisher? So those are the two questions.
Yeah, and those are related questions. So with the novel, I did initially try going out the traditional agent route. And I found after my first round, that first year of submissions, that the novel wasn't ready yet. You know, and nobody told me that, but just like the deafening silence told me that. So I did another round of editing, and I also decided to loosen up my ideas of how I was supposed to be publishing. So I included small presses in with agents and really looked for places where it would be a fit and not try to squeeze it into a mode of publishing that maybe it didn't belong in. Because I do write between genres, even when I'm writing speculative. I write the kind of speculative that doesn't neatly fit on the sci-fi shelf. And so I decided, you know, why don't I just let it be its little changeling in between thing? And I found a small press with which the book resonated, and they invested a lot of time and effort in, you know, a thorough editing process, the cover. See, then you know somebody's really invested. And it's not getting passed around from one editor to the other, and maybe the editor leaves and your book is orphaned, as they call it. So I was very happy with the small press experience, such that all of my books have actually been published through small presses. And, you know, there are positives and negatives to that. One of the potential negatives is that you do wind up doing a lot of your publicity. I don't mind doing that. And in fact, that's increasingly an experience people have with large publishers as well, where they wind up doing a lot of their own publicity. I would rather have that involvement in, you know, the strategy and the cover and what people are saying about it, and have it be genuine and authentic. Then have it become part of a larger machine that may not see it the same way that I do. So for me, that's been what I'm comfortable doing, because I see my career as a writer as not just being published, but also being part of a literary community and teaching. So I don't rest my identity as a writer on one aspect of that. But it's different for everybody else. And for some people, they really want to be published with a major publisher and have that be their identity. And that is completely fine for them. But just know that there are more ways of shaping your identity than being published by a major press.
So we covered, I think, most of my revision. I had several revision questions. I think we've covered them. There's one that I did want to follow up with. So continuing our staggered revision conversation here. We've talked about some of the processes you go through revision, but how do you preserve the best qualities of a first draft? How do you identify what's valuable, and how do you make sure you don't lose? Especially with rage, there's something in the moment. And if you lost that, it probably wouldn't work, I would think. So is that something you experience, and how do you make sure that something, that oomph at the very beginning, sticks around?
You know, I think that is by, well, it's kind of counter intuitive. I'm saying two different things now, so let me prepare you. One is that I can conserve the rage by doing my research and being confident in my conviction that what I initially thought is in fact the case, and that no, in fact, you know, the excuses are not valid and this is actually, you know, something terrible. Ironically, by doing the research and, you know, being responsible, you can afford to keep that, you know, that passion of the initial statement. And another thing is being willing to, you know, file it away if it turns out not to be correct, or if you can't justify what you've written, like being okay letting it go. That's another part of it. It's just that honesty, you know, and not being, not feeling the need to sort of do mental gymnastics to make that initial impression correct. So it really comes down to, you know, do I feel comfortable putting this out there? And can I justify what I said? And as long as that's the case, then yes, I can go ahead and let it stay angry.
That's really interesting too, what you said about knowing when to let it go. Because I feel like that's something I've learned in revision on the small scale. So like revising a novel, usually I'll be futzing with a paragraph and I'll just mess with it. Like, oh, select all, you know, delete, it's gone. The reason I kept messing with that paragraph was because it didn't actually need to exist. I couldn't make it work because it didn't work. There was no form of it that would. So it's interesting to see that taken to the macro scale, where recognizing that an entire piece, I mean, God forbid a novel, or, you know, God forbid something too big, but like, I think that's that level of honesty and that level of, for me, revision is also the process of learning to recognize more of those moments where letting go of something, it's more than just the kill your darling sort of cliche. There's something much more fundamental than that too. It's like, no, this, the place I'm snagged in just endless editing is usually a place that's, tear it all down.
Yeah. I just had that moment with a short story where I was really like agonizing. I mean, so it was a story about a scientific experiment that takes place in an earthen hut. And so I was out here with my tape measure trying to think, okay, how big would the tank actually be if you had 1,000 gallons of water? And could people like have a crane, a winch above it to lift the thing out of the tank? And like I had my husband like holding the tape measure with me, you know? And so I went through all this. And then a couple of days later, I came back to the manuscript. I'm like, nobody needs to know this. Just take it out. I don't, you know, that was ridiculous that I went through all that time. So, you know, time is also an incredibly powerful editing tool. You know, at the moment it seems so important and vital that I, you know, portray this properly. And I, you know, actually I did get to look at some really cool, aquarium websites based on this research. So that was a gain, right? I got something out of it, but that whole paragraph was just like, it's gone. It was so unnecessary. And I think part of I don't know if people consider it brave to let go of that kind of thing, but part of what helps me do that is I am working on more than one piece at a time. And so if I have to let go of one, it's not like my artistic output is like, you know, evaporating into the ether. And so I would just like to encourage people to go ahead and start writing it. That doesn't mean you have to finish it. And I know I'm not supposed to be saying that as a writing teacher, but I would rather have people write drafts that are doomed to never see the light of day than to not start on it because they don't know how it's going to end or where they're going to publish it. It's much better to get it out there and let it be what it is or isn't going to be than to be sort of like keeping yourself back from writing it because it has to be perfect.
And I think there's too, sometimes the thing you delete did teach you something.
Exactly.
Like just because you deleted it doesn't mean it was a waste of time. It just means that it wasn't part of the final product. Everything you delete is still part of the product somewhere in your own head. So I think it helps me not to recognize too that this wasn't a waste of time. Those 3 days I spent looking at this one paragraph was, all to delete it. Exactly. Like it wasn't a waste. That was just me getting to where I needed to be.
Right.
So I have a few more questions too, but we have probably time for a writing is lasagna. Is it layered? It's layered from Amy. Thank you, Amy. From now on, all our writing metaphors will be pasta.
Right. Pasta and lips.
That's all you need to know about writing. Yes.
I mean, that's it. There's your MFA, you know?
Amy, you can make pasta lips. No, that would be weird. Never mind. Just straight paragraph cut from entire.
Yeah, that's not going in the final version.
I'm going to go edit this video right now as soon as we're done to get that out. So if anyone else has any questions, we might have time for one or two more questions from the audience. So please type those in now. In the meantime, so this book is very, very conscious of the crap we're in right now as America, as the world, as whatever grouping you want to look for. So what should artists be doing right now? What is the responsibility of artists?
You know, I feel like the responsibility as artists is to, as I keep saying, educate ourselves and to be able to clearly articulate what we're seeing in the world in terms of, you know, if you want to get political, to be able to clearly articulate and not like an essay, right? Because people take in information in different ways. Some people want to read the news reports. Some people want to read the essays. Other folks just, that's not their interest. But if they see something, if they see a poem about a situation, that may pique their interest and that may be their education. Or if they see a satirical piece, you know, that may be a way someone takes in information. So, I mean, look at all the late night talk shows, you know, that's the way so many people are getting their news, and it's not a traditional news format. So I think we have a role to play if we're writing about topical things, to really try to be as clear as we can be about, you know, what the issue, what the central problem is here. And it's not necessarily talking about specific policies, but like that example I gave with the Le Guin story, you know, what is the central issue? And that's really what's going to be that timelessness in your piece. Because when we're looking at anger, it's because something isn't going the way we think it should be going. And I think, you know, what can unify people is a basic belief in fairness. Like when you look at why these situations make you angry, be it, you know, reproductive rights or racism or police violence, there is an essential lack of fairness going on there. And I think that's something that is a basic human instinct. I hope so, at least, right? People want other folks to survive and to have what they need to live. And some people have way freaking more than they need to live. And so, you know, regardless of which specific situation you're talking about, if you're thinking about it in terms of those basic human elements of fairness and love, people want love, people want family. You know, that's what you're tapping into with this political work, whether you know it or not. And if you're writing from that space of trying to understand that fairness, like where is that fairness? Where is that one human quality we all want and that we should all have, regardless of the specific policy? I think that's what people are reacting to when they're angry. And, you know, especially when it's something that doesn't affect you directly. You know, when you see men fighting for women's reproductive rights, they're talking about justice and fairness, even when it doesn't, you know, affect them personally in their own bodies. And so that, I think, is something that we can tap into and that we're speaking to when we're, you know, looking at really effective political work. And that's a dimension that you can get to beyond any sort of paper, beyond a news report. And that, I think, is our job as artists to really get down to the very human elements of what we're seeing today and figuring out why this upsets us. Now, in terms of specific policy prescriptions, I don't see that as the job of the author, but I see our job is to sort of reassure people that yes, you know, you're right to be angry that things aren't fair. You're right to be angry that people don't have enough food to eat. You're right to be angry that folks are getting beaten up and killed for the color of their skin. You know, you're right to be angry. Now, other people will tell you exactly what to do. And I do that on my Facebook page, right? I talk about voting, talk about like making sure you have your mail-in voter registration, make sure you know where to drop it off in case the mail goes kablooey. So that's a different thing from being a writer. A writer is really about focusing on what it means to be a human being and how we can feel about that and how we interpret the world based on what it means to be human.
I like the thoughtfulness aspect too. I feel like thoughtfulness, especially as writers and artists, is a thing. Okay, my book isn't going to have 2 million readers, but the people who make TV shows are readers. People who make movies are readers. They're engaging with visual art in art museums, and these things which may not seem like they have huge audiences, mm-hmm. is part of a giant ecosystem. And I and the discussions that are now finally starting to happen at a more public level are familiar to, I think, some of us who've been in writing for a while, because we heard them from people in the writing community a long time ago. So it's useful there too, just to be mm-hmm. part of that conversation. So I want to end with this. We have one question I think we're going to end with, because it's an important question. Have you ever written a poem or article that you thought was great and then go back a week or month later and think it's awful?
Oh my God.
You still consider submitting it?
Every week. My light just went out. That's how important that question was. Yeah, the light's like, I don't want to be here for this because I know. I mean, that's definitely part of writing. And that's actually why I encourage folks to give their manuscript breath before you send it out. Because when you finish it, you're convinced you're brilliant. And then this is the wonderful, the greatest thing. And you could even look at it. I mean, I've looked at something like 2 days after I submitted it somewhere. I'm like, oh my God, Jesus, help me. I can't believe I sent that out, because you're in the throes and you're in your head and you know what you intend to be on the page, and it isn't there when you get there 2 days later. So all of these teachers tell you to set your manuscript aside, and they're absolutely correct, because that happens to everybody.
Well, I think that's going to wrap us up then. Tara, thank you so much for joining us this evening. It's always a pleasure to talk to you. This was a lot of fun too, to
thank
get to revisit
so
this book a second time and chat about it.
Could just mention that question, someone typed in, or you're convinced it sucks. Now, I see that with so many of my students, and we have this amazing ability to convince ourselves on both sides of that spectrum. And most of what I see from my students, and they think it's just, horrific, I'm like, what are you talking about? This is amazing. And, lean into that, because that's fantastic. Or you can tweak this. The whole thing is not a garbage pile. You're just seeing it like a garbage pile, because you're you, and, all the, the cracks that went into it. But, it's part of what I was talking about with the mentors. They were just telling me what I was doing that I wasn't seeing myself. They were able to reflect the work I was putting into the writing and the community. And so it was like that objective view that was telling me, okay, maybe I'm not absolute garbage. But so yes, writers, you're not wonderful from the first draft, neither are you garbage. That's what time and your writing community can help you work your way through.
Thank you again so much. Thank you everyone for coming out. Please order a copy of the book. Emily, if you would toss that link. Oh, look at that. Those links are back up. Please check out writer.org, our website, to see our upcoming workshops and events. We have a whole bunch more free events coming up, so I'd love to see some more of you at some of those events in the next few weeks. And thanks to everyone for coming out.